The title of the sermon is Behold the Man, and that'll make sense when we get to it. But we're in John 18, beginning in verse 28, and we're going to be talking about Pilate today because Annas and Caiaphas came last week. So last week I told you I had to break the story up, the interrogations and trials of Jesus. I plan to cover all of them, but it's just too much material. Even today there's really too much to cover, so I'm going to have to leave some details out. But last week we considered Annas, the official high priest over Jerusalem, over Israel, and his son-in-law Caiaphas, the Roman-placed high priest, and some of the tension there with Jesus. And finally, they cart him off to Pilate, Pontius Pilate. We'll just call him Pilate the rest of the morning. They send him to Pilate, the governor of Judea, to be executed. And they really had no plans for a trial. They wanted to expedite execution. They were ready to kill Jesus. And that's where we find ourselves today in John 18. Before we read the text, would you pray with me for the Lord's blessing? Father God, as we open the Bible today in peace, we are aware that around this nation there are protests and riots, that there's hatred and violence as well as peaceful protests, that there are people who are wounded by the pangs of racism and societal indifference. We are fearful for the future for our brothers and sisters, not only in this country but around the world, who are treated differently for any various reason, most commonly right now because of the color of skin. And we pray for your blessing upon the people of this country, that we would be united in peace, that we would learn to love in spite of differences. Help us to seek peace and reconciliation rather than resorting to violence and angry outbursts. May we respect others, their dignity as well as their property. May we do all things in a manner that pleases you. And may we, the church, remain vocal on issues of injustice, even as Jesus teaches in your word. We pray for justice to roll down like waters and righteousness as a never-ending stream. For your glory, and for your good pleasure. May you bless our time in the Word today as we better understand Jesus, his humility, and the essence of his kingship. And may we glorify you in our study. We ask it in the name of your Son and through the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. This sermon was planned long before the issues in pop culture arose this past week, but I think it is especially pertinent. And in many ways, I won't even have to draw the connections for you. It will just be natural. But we see some things in this text before we get into that. And I want to read the text with you. The words will be on the screen from the English Standard Version. If you have something else, that's perfectly fine. Just try to follow along with me. Chapter 18, verse 28 and following. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters, that is Pilate. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters so that they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Notice they don't give an accusation. Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken, to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from this world." Then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him. But you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" And they cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Barabbas was a robber or an insurrectionist. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. And they came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said to them, "Ecce homo, behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God." And when Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" And Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you're not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. And he said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" And Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" And the chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. It's a dark text. There's a lot going on in such a short narrative. And so some points I want to draw forward before we move into a discussion of truth and meaning, which I think is captured here. There are some points that we just need to mention because we'd be remiss not to. The first of them is the pain and humiliation of Jesus' torture. The pain and humiliation of Jesus' torture. It's obvious by a collective witness of the four Gospels that Jesus was probably flogged twice and at the very least was flogged nearly to death once. On top of that, he's humiliated, dressed up as a king. And what you may not understand is the picture that's being drawn here by John. In the ancient Near East, it was customary for kings to have pointy crowns that seemed to be sun rays to the heavens. It was sign of God's blessing, a sign of power and authority, sometimes even a divine symbol for other ancient Near Eastern ethnicities. In this case, they've woven together a pointy crown, but it's made of thorns that stick into the brow of Jesus and draw blood. They've turned a sign of deity and kingship into a torture device upon his head. Then they've taken purple robes meant to honor a king, a sign of royalty, and they've draped them over his bloody body. And they hail him King of the Jews while they strike him again and again. They're mocking him. They're degrading him. They're condescending. And we can't miss that, because in that moment we see a picture of God's love. That the God who created these very people has allowed himself to bear flesh like them and be degraded by them. That the people over whom he is the rightful king are now belittling him and making fun of his kingship. And he allows it to go on. Not only that, he'll soon enough die for those people. We can't overlook the pain, the humiliation of Jesus. If this is the kind of king we serve, then he is approachable. Any king who would become like this, who would allow himself to be made the jester of the court rather than remain on his throne, is the kind of king who wants to be with you, who wants you to be with him. Secondly, there's great irony in this text. Just as we've mentioned the true kingship of Jesus, we have to consider the temporary position of Caesar or even of Pilate as a governor. Here are men established temporarily on thrones that hold some power, but not unlimited power, and they seek to bind and condemn and execute the God and King of all kings. who made them and put them in their positions. It's the height of irony. And John wants us to see it. Here comes the dignified King Jesus from the garden, ready to embrace his destiny. And he's bound by soldiers, while heavenly hosts of angels wait in the ranks to attack. And he's carted off to a high priest who tries him, although he himself is the great high priest of the order of Melchizedek, as we talked about last week. And now he's brought before a governor, and eventually the name Caesar, the Lord of the Roman Empire, and here is the Lord of glory. It's irony, and it has great poetic purpose for John. The king has become the jester, but he's allowed it to happen. And that's because he comes from a different kind of kingdom. So the third thing I want to point out is the two kingdoms. And I'm not a dualist. I don't think the Bible is a dualist book. But I think there are dualistic elements sometimes, the this versus that. And we see it here, this kingdom versus Jesus' kingdom, meaning the kingdom of Rome, ancient world empire, which is very much like today's modern empires and nations. Here is a world system plagued by sin and corruption. And here's Jesus, come from on high, bearing the kingship of his heavenly kingdom, which is very different. Not only are there two kingdoms, but two kings, Jesus versus Caesar. And at the end of this account, we find those haunting words that I would argue are the most haunting in all of the Passion narrative, when the Jewish people cry out, "We have no king but Caesar." A phrase we barely talk about or preach about, and yet one that I have never forgotten since I read it, because I can't help but see that they have, in that moment, chosen Caesar instead of Jesus. Because they serve Caesar's kingdom and not the kingdom of our Christ and God. Two kingdoms. But what we misunderstand about the two kingdoms is their location. When Jesus says that his kingdom is not from this world, that's what he's saying. In some of this, verse 36, some of these translations say of this world, but then the final one says, my kingdom is not from the world. From is a better term, because from describes its source rather than its location. Jesus is bringing his kingdom into the world. When we say his kingdom is not of the world, we are led into this false dichotomy that there's this world and a world to come, and we better make it to the world to come. What we misunderstand is God's plan is to bring the world to come into this world and recreate. The story of Scripture is not us being called up into the heavens, but Jesus bringing the heavens and his army to the earth to destroy evil and recreate what was meant to be from the beginning. And that's something we don't have time to get into today, but it's a misunderstanding of a few different verses, particularly in Thessalonians and Revelation. But the picture is never God taking us out of the world, but him coming into the world, saving the world, and preparing it for his return. We wait not for Jesus to make us all disappear, but for Jesus to come back and lead us into a new heavens and a new earth. And that changes things, because now his mission is not to get people out of this world to stop serving Caesar and start serving him and go to a heavenly kingdom, but rather to understand even while Caesar is here, Jesus is somewhere up above him and has a greater plan for his people, that this is all temporary and what he has in store will last for an eternity. And in that way, we are required to bring heaven to earth. If his plan is to bring heaven to earth, then we have to bring heaven to earth. We can't just disregard the earth and head over to heaven when we die. Now, if you still don't understand why this is so pressing, turn on the news for 5 minutes. If the church turns a blind eye to the issues that we face in society because we just got to get out of this hellhole and get to heaven one day, then we've completely misunderstood Jesus and his mission on earth, because he came to establish a kingdom, not to already have a kingdom and just take us away to it. I hope you're starting to see how different those ideas are, because I think most modern American Christians fall under the prior rather than the latter. They think Jesus did just come to take us away into the clouds. When my dad died, my mom was crying, and I probably told you this before, but she said, "You know, I just wonder what he's doing right now. I wonder if, you know, if he's happy." And my dad was a believer in Jesus, and I don't doubt that he's in God's care. But I told her, he's not bored, if that's what you're saying. And that is sort of what she was saying. I'm worried that he's, you know, he's not happy. Because in her imagination, heaven was some cloud far away that God was going to let us sit on for eternity and play harps. But that's not the picture in Scripture. It's a new created order. It's everything that's beautiful about this world and all of its cultures coming together in perfect harmony. The very best of food and music and everything else coming together in an orderly way that leads to peace instead of violence, to love instead of hate. It's the world we all imagined we lived in, and even better than that. And it's our job to recreate it now in the name of Jesus to attract people into it so that when he comes again, they'll be a part of his work. And so here we see the division of two kingdoms, not one over here and one over there, but one that is greater and long-lasting, that's interceding and intervening and taking over the other. And we get to be a part of that mission. As we're called into that mission, John explains it in a unique way by presenting to us Barabbas. In fact, Barabbas is present in all four Gospels, which is always an important thing. Barabbas, historically, we believe his name was Jesus Barabbas. Don't forget, Jesus is not God's son's name. It's the name Joshua in Hebrew. Yeshua is shortened for Yehoshua, which means Yahweh will save. So you have the Hebrew name, God will save, followed by, in this case, Barabbas, which means son of the father in Aramaic. You have the same name as Jesus, followed by son of the father. Now, that cannot be accidental. Here is a murderer and an insurrectionist who is considered a son of the father in name, whose name is the very same as Jesus. Although Jesus is the true son of the father, and he is presented beside Jesus to the people. Here is their king, the true son of the father, and here's a murderer, known insurrectionist, a rebel rouser. Take your choice, I'll release one of them. And the people say, we'll take the murderer. Here are two sons of the Father, which will you choose? And in some way, I think John is challenging us to consider, which will we be? Or which will we choose? This question was not merely for the crowd before Pilate, but for every individual who will come face to face with Jesus. Will they be sons of the Father of this world, the devil? Will they serve the systems of injustice and hate and violence? Will they perpetuate the problems of this world? Or will they join Jesus in his unstoppable effort to reclaim this world and correct the problems of sin, to undo the evil that we've caused? It's the choice that we all have to make. And that choice is directly tied to a struggle for power. And struggles for power are directly tied to truth. As we search for truth, we lose power. As we forsake truth, we gain power. It's the perfect imbalance of this world. That's why we believe there are very few good politicians at high levels, because most of us know what it takes to get to a high-level office in politics, some forsaking of truth. Now, that's not a blanket statement. I'm sure there are some decent politicians in high offices, but you know what I mean. We sort of assume that for someone to make it to that level, they've had to forsake truth along the way, because most often in our culture and in the world society, truth and power do not go hand in hand, but they are counterbalanced. The more power you have, the less truth you have to hold on to, or the more truth you have to let go of. Vice versa, the more truth you understand, the less power you have, or the more aware you are of the powerlessness that you have. That might be a better way to put it. Pilate has believed the greatest lie ever told. He's executed the only innocent man who's ever walked the earth, all in his pursuit of power. It's the turn of phrase at the end when they say, this man claimed to be king. Any man who claims to be king is an opponent to Caesar. And don't you want to be a friend of Caesar, Pilate? That's the moment that he breaks. Until then, he refused to give them Jesus. He said he didn't want anything to do with it. The other gospels say he washes his hands publicly. This is not going to be on his head. The blood will be on them, not on his hands. Until this point, when he's threatened by losing power. Because at this point, through history, we know Pilate has already upset the Jewish people numerous times. There have been at least four rebellions at this point. All of them have probably reached the ears of Caesar in Rome, and it could be any moment, and Pilate will be deposed as the governor of Judea. Just one more mishap, and he'll be removed from office. He'll lose all of his power, his authority, his prestige, his income, his fame. And so when he hears the threat that he'll be an enemy of Caesar rather than a friend to Caesar, he remembers his mentor, who, if this happened in 32 or 33 AD, had just been executed by Caesar, although he was one of his closest friends. And Pilate feels the pressure, the political pressure, the corruption of sacrificing the truth in order to maintain power. and he fails the test. Jesus, on the other hand, has all power and all authority, and he stands robed as the court jester, mocked, though he is the King of all kings. He stands in humility, although he has all authority. It's a picture in words. It's a painting of God's purpose and intention that John has spread on these pages. Ravi Zacharias, as many of you know, passed away this week, roughly a week ago. He was a great apologist and defender of the Christian faith, a great public speaker, and wrote many good books that help us better understand our Christian faith. He was deeply indebted to philosophy, and as a fellow student of philosophy, I've liked Ravi Zacharias for a long time. I was saddened to hear that he died. I'm happy that his faith is now sight, but I feel sorrow for his family and his friends. But it forced me to go back and read some things that I've read from Ravi Zacharias, and one of them was something I wrote in a notebook that he said one time, that the two greatest questions human beings will ever ask are, what is truth, and what does it mean to be human? What does it mean to be here, to be alive? What's the meaning of life? So truth and meaning, those are the two greatest questions philosophically that all people will ask. What is truth? What is meaning? Now, we could argue in postmodernity, after modernity and its empirical study for absolute truth, and then the reaction of that with all these existential theories that we cannot know. Basically, we've come out a generation of skeptics and cynics. We don't believe you can know absolute truth. Everything is relative. Pluralism reigns. And I think you've seen the aftermath of that just in the last decade. There is no truth. Your truth is your truth, as Oprah says, and my truth is my truth. We get that. But Ravi Zacharias has a point. Even when we live in a society that says you cannot know truth absolutely, we're still looking for it. In a world that says there is no meaning, you just die and that's it, we're still seeking meaning anywhere we can find it. Because at the core of humanity is a desire to know truth and to have meaning. And I think he's absolutely right. And in this one narrative between Jesus and Pilate, both questions are answered. One, quite literally, when Pilate says, "What is truth?" and walks out on Jesus, forsaking truth in the flesh. And the second, when he says, "Ecce homo, behold man," and presents to us what humanity really means and what it looks like, and hands him over to be crucified. It's amazing, really, the deep philosophy bound in this one story. So let's start with the first question. What is truth? What is truth? Well, there's propositional truth, which is simple courtroom logic, right? It's what we use with empirical evidence. I could say, this is a spoon, for example. If I had a spoon in my hand, I'd tell you, this is a spoon, it is not a car. And both statements are true, because I said what is, and what is not. But what if I said something is not, or that something that is not is? Well, that makes it not true. That's a little complicated, but I'll clear it up for you. So what if I said a spoon was a car? Is that true? No, because you know what makes a spoon. It scoops things, you eat with it. You know what makes a car. It's got tires, it drives. This is not a car, it's a spoon. So if I say it is what it is not, that's false. What if I say this is not a spoon? I really wish I remembered my spoon. It's sitting on my desk right now. I knew I was gonna forget to bring it up here, but imagine I have a spoon, okay? What if I tell you this spoon is not a spoon? Well, that's false, because I said what is not. So if I say something is, that's true. If I say what it is not, that is also true. That's propositional truth. It really is quite simple. But what about in ethics or morality or philosophical notions? That propositional truth doesn't hold water, because you cannot empirically say this is or is not. What if I asked you, if a young woman had been raped by her uncle and the baby was going to cost her life, should she bear that child, or is she allowed to abort that child? Well, we believe in the sanctity of life, at least I hope you do, but we also understand that that creates a gray area in morals. It creates an ethical gray area for us, right? That's a tougher decision. I use that example because that's a pretty good one. That's a heavy-handed one. I pray that none of you ever have to make a choice like that, but that creates problems. It's not as simple as, well, a baby's a baby. Propositional truth can only take you so far. And in our culture, we stop there. Anything beyond propositional truth cannot be known as truth, because it's subjective. But what if there is objective truth beyond the propositional? What if there is truth we can know without empirical evidence to prove it in some way? For example, faith in Jesus and his resurrection. We may not have empirical evidence to say, here he is standing risen, but we know they did, and there were eyewitness accounts, and we know people died believing that it was true, and so that's enough for many of us to accept it's a historical reality. The proposition has no genuine evidence right now to support it beyond word of mouth and oral tradition, the Gospels, but we still believe it. That's one little detail. What about something even beyond that? Just a promise God makes in the Bible that he'll turn all things together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose in Romans 8. I believe that in faith because propositionally I can't prove that right now. But I believe it's true because I believe in the objective truth of God and his word. I hope this is making sense. So there's objective truth beyond what is propositional. Jesus is trying to define truth in a way that isn't just propositional, and Pilate doesn't understand. And so he flippantly says, what is truth? And he walks out. At least that's how I imagine it going down in my mind. He says to Jesus, what is truth? And he walks out of the room. That's probably how you read it also, because he felt the frustration we feel. He lived in pagan Rome, a pluralistic, relativistic society that worshiped a plethora of gods. Some of them had kids. Some of them were demigods that were the children of gods and people, and they had special abilities and all of this in their myths and legends, which he may or may not have believed. But he lived in a time with all these cultures under Roman occupation with all different gods that they worshiped, and he himself probably didn't know what to believe. And so he looks to Jesus as a relative pluralist, and he says, what is truth? And he's looking at truth, objective reality, and he doesn't even realize it. It's crazy. What is truth? If someone asked you, what is truth, what would you say? How would you explain truth to someone? It's rhetorical, you don't have to answer. Well, I asked some friends this week, and I wrote down what our answers were. Just 5 points that we quickly came up with. Truth is unchanging. Truth is unchanging. Lies can be altered, but the truth cannot be. Secondly, truth doesn't need to be overexplained. If truth is actually true, you don't have to explain it to death. And you certainly don't have to gimmick the truth to make it more attractive or to convince people that it's true. If it's true, it's true, it's true all the time. Truth is truth no matter what. It doesn't need to be explained to remain true. Thirdly, truth can be challenging. In some ways, offensive at times. The truth can offend. The truth can be challenging. Lies tickle people's fancies. They coddle people. But the truth can sometimes hurt. The truth can be challenging. Fourthly, the truth must be objective. This we've already talked about. If something is subjective, it is automatically no longer truth, but opinion. For something to be true, it must be objective, meaning true always for everyone all the time. It's true. That's truth. Finally, truth doesn't need to be stated in order to remain true. Whether or not you know that it's true, for thousands of years, people did not understand the law of gravity. But did that mean gravity wasn't true? No. I just came up with that, but that's a really good example. It doesn't have to be stated to be true. Something is true regardless of whether you know it or say it. Now, let me turn those points to Jesus. Because after I got those points written down and my friends disbanded, I went to my Bible and some Google searching, and I found answers to all of these points in the life of Jesus. I won't read all the scriptures to you, but I promise you, if you read your Bibles, you'll find these to be true. Jesus is described in John's gospel as the way, the truth, and the life, which in my mind are three ways of saying the same thing, that he is the penultimate truth. He's the only way to access God who is truth. He's the only way to truly live. But it's all really the different ways of saying the same thing. If Jesus is the ultimate truth, then everything he says is true. And so these could apply to Jesus or his message, his words. So Jesus or his words remain eternally unchanging. That's the first point. There is no shadow due to change with God, unchanging forever. Secondly, Jesus doesn't need to be overexplained or gimmicked. And we see this a lot in the modern American church and around the world. We see people who sort of add gimmicks to the gospel. We don't talk a lot about it here because we're not trying to bash other churches, but you've seen it sometimes when people think Jesus on his own isn't enough, so we have to add some gimmicks and flashy stuff and make him more attractive to people, as if the truth isn't already convincing. The truth is convincing on its own. It doesn't need to be gimmicked. Thirdly, Jesus can be challenging. I think you would agree. Jesus, as the truth embodied, can be offensive, can be hard to accept at times. He challenges us. Fourthly, Jesus is not subjective, but objective. If truth has to be objective, then Jesus must be objective. And John 3:16, which we all know and love, tells us that Jesus is objective, that all the world might be saved through him. God did not plan that only a few could be saved if he felt like it, but he invites all to be saved. His love is objective. His truth is objective. And finally, Jesus didn't have to say a word to Pilate in order to remain true. Pilate says, "What's truth?" And he walks out. But that did not change the fact that truth was standing right there before him. Jesus was the truth, whether stated or in silence. So we know about truth, and we know that Jesus is the truth, but what about being a human? That second question of meaning, what does it mean to be alive? What does it mean to have a human nature? What does it mean to be a person, a man or a woman? Surely you've thought about this before. Like, what's the purpose of life? Why are we all here? What does it mean to be alive? And Pilate answers us, I think, unknowingly by saying, "Ecce homo," behold man. Behold man. Here's man on display. Jesus in his bloody robes and his crown of thorns. This is man. A verse that's been in my mind all week, watching the news and reading about current events, has been Micah, the prophet, chapter 6, verse 8. We'll put it on the screen, but I think you've heard it before. God says to us, "O mortals," says, "O man," but a good translation would be mortals or people. You human beings, you men and women, what is good? What does the Lord require of you? Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with God. Do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with God. So now we could take those three points and say that's a pretty quick description of what it means to glorify God as his image bearer. If we, men and women, are image bearers of God, if we are called to glorify him in our living, how are we to live in order to do it? Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with God. So then we have to turn those three points to Jesus and Pilate and consider what they've done. Let's look at Pilate first. Did Pilate do justice? No. He offers tacit approval of the crucifixion of Jesus when he washes his hands in the other gospels, where in this case, when he says, "I want nothing to do with it, I don't see any guilt in him," but allows Jesus to be carted off for execution, he has tacitly approved of the murder of an innocent man. Whether or not he wants the credit for it, he will have it. In God's eyes, he has done injustice. Worse than that, he's released a guilty man rather than the innocent one. He's exchanged the life of an innocent man for the life of one who is known to be guilty by everyone around. And now we have to consider, do we do justice? Are we as Pilate was? And I think sometimes we don't do justice. I don't think we want to admit it, but I think it's obvious if you watch us long enough that Christians do not always practice justice. If you've been paying attention this past week, we've seen so-called Christians exercising their rights on both ends of the spectrum in ways that produce racism, hate, violence, bigotry, greed, and concern over money rather than people, selfishness, political corruption. All of this we've seen from self-professed believers in Jesus. People who claim to follow our Lord have exercised their right to show all of these things. Things that are in direct opposition to justice. But I don't think we understand how serious that offense is to God. In the Old Testament, when the people lived in constant injustice toward their neighbors, God destroyed entire cities. And some of you are still angry that they looted a Target. I'm not saying they did something right. I'm simply saying God has done far worse in the face of injustice. Of course, God owns the people and the targets, so he's allowed to do that. That's why I disagree with their actions. God can destroy an entire city if he chooses, if they are practicing injustice toward fellow human beings. We should care more. And I don't have enough time to go in depth with this, but the gospel carries the weight of social justice. Whether you like it or not, to follow Jesus is to bring justice into an unjust world. And all through John's gospel, Jesus has presented justice toward people who were being treated with injustice. And that leads to the next point, kindness. Did Pilate love kindness? No. He flogged an innocent man possibly twice to the point of death and then sent him off to carry his cross to crucifixion. That's not kindness. Pilate doesn't seem to love kindness. Read any story about Pilate in ancient history and you'll see he was never known to be a kind person. And thirdly, walk humbly with God. Pilate disregards God's own son in the flesh, but he also disregards his wife's visions, which isn't in John's gospel, but the other three. We know that Pilate's wife had visions from God, and Pilate disregards those visions and forsakes the Son of God, instead choosing to walk in line with Caesar to protect his power. It's the very opposite of humility before God. He shows arrogance by carting God's son off to be executed in order to maintain a good face before the emperor. And so perhaps unknowingly, this Judean governor has now exchanged the life of the immortal Son of God, the King of heaven and King of all kings, so that he can stay a little closer to a man on a throne in Rome. It's unbelievable. But in contrast to Pilate and his mistakes, we see all throughout John's gospel and all four gospels that Jesus has done justice. He has done nothing but justice all of his life, caring for those who needed to be cared for, helping and healing and feeding and serving, loving the unlovable or the seemingly so, reaching out to those who no one else reached out to, setting free those who had been bound by demon oppression or by societal standards. Those who had been kept held down, Jesus sets them free. He does justice everywhere he goes. He certainly loved kindness. Jesus loved kindness. He was kind even to sinners. It earned him a bad reputation with the Pharisees because he was a friend to sinners and tax collectors. He loved people and showed them kindness when others showed them hate. Jesus was kind. We see his mercy and his patience all over the gospel narratives. Even in his trial, he's allowed this other Jesus, Barabbas, a murderer, to go in his place. Jesus could have stopped that, but he wanted that to happen because that's why Jesus came, was to set people free like Barabbas and give them a new beginning. People like Peter last week who denied their closest friend and master. He looks at Peter when the rooster crows. And Peter is soon restored and sent out on mission. Jesus came for those kinds of people, for people like us. And so he shows kindness. And finally, most obvious of all, Jesus walks humbly with his Father. Jesus walks humbly with God. He walks humbly all the way to the cross. But if there is any doubt in your mind about the humility of Jesus, I think it's cleared up in John 18 and 19 when he's flogged and beaten and humiliated in public. When they dress him up as a king and mock him, I think it's proof, more proof than we need, of his humility as he walks in the footsteps of faith. He's prayed in the garden, and his God, his Father, has called him to this task. It's in these moments when Jesus will act out this greatest humility imaginable, and in turn accomplished the greatest reconciliation imaginable. It's in these moments we see the baby born in a manger, and it makes sense. Because here he is now, having lived the life of a nomadic teacher with very little respect from his contemporaries, now drawn into the holy city during a holy festival bringing peace, and instead he's bound prisoner and embarrassed and humiliated and flogged publicly, and soon enough executed. All while he has the power to stop it at a moment's notice. All of this when he could have squashed his enemies like bugs, but he walks faithfully to the cross. It's that moment, or these moments collectively, that we do ecce homo, behold man, because this is what man was always meant to be, just and kind and humble, walking with God every step. Here is the picture of God's love on display, the epitome of all truth, bound up in this one man, namely Jesus Christ. Behold the man. Here he stands, bloodied and beaten wearing his purple robe and his crown of thorns, preparing to ascend his throne across to be killed by his own people. Behold the man. When Pilate asked Jesus, "What is truth?" I don't think he understood that the truth was standing in front of him. And when he tells the crowd, "Behold man," he doesn't understand that this is the perfect picture of manhood, of humanness. He's clueless to what he has said, but he has answered the two greatest questions human beings will ever ask. And both answers are bound up in Jesus. He is truth. He is humanness on display. If you are seeking answers to those questions, look no further than Jesus. For when we look at Jesus, when we behold the only begotten Son of God, we see perfect humanity. Behold him. Pilate tried to get rid of Jesus. He didn't want the guilt to be on his hands or hanging over his head. He wanted to get rid of Jesus. He tried to embarrass him in front of the crowd. He hurt him repeatedly, flogged him, and sent him back out. And what we see in this narrative is not Pilate who hates Jesus, but Pilate who's fearful that Jesus might be telling the truth and wants to get out of the situation before it gets any uglier. And so he's trying again and again and again to convince the people to just take Jesus back and deal with him their own way. But finally, they say, "We can't, because we can't kill him, and that's what needs to be done. You're the only one, Pilate, who can kill him for us." And Pilate says, "Well, I don't see any guilt in him. I'm not going to kill him." And they say, "Oh, really? He said he was the Son of God." And Pilate says, "Okay, I'm not going to kill him." And finally, they catch Pilate. They say, "Okay, he said he's king. Caesar is the only king, Pilate. And don't you want to be Caesar's friend?" A friend of Caesar becomes a title not very many years after this in ancient Roman writings. A title, friend of Caesar, for those who were in close connection with the emperor. Pilate wants to be one of those people. He wants to be a friend of Caesar. And so now they've given him the real question that was at stake. Who will your master be? Who will your king be? And so the final behold, the final question is not what is truth or what is man, but behold your king. And that's by far the most important question. Because once you've studied the truth and you've considered what it means to be a human, now you have to choose sides. Who will you serve? And Pilate says, "Behold your king." And they say, "We have no king but Caesar." Who is your king?